Are you a Baloo or a Bagheera? Like in Jungle Book, Bagheera the panther was very focused on getting Mowgli to the village, whereas Baloo was much more chilled and wanting to explore and do this and do that, but also get things done along the way. So what it means is for you, like in your current company, should you try to rise or should you explore other companies, right? Should you get better at what you are doing right now, like Java programming, or should you try to jump to machine learning and AI? And all over your life, not just career, you have to take this decision, right?
Question.
Yeah.
Are we technically both? Like, there are times when I feel like a Baloo, especially during the weekends. Mm-hmm. And then there are times when I feel like a Bagheera. I want to get this task done. I want to get this achievement. I want to get this progress in my career.
Correct. So, in fact, let me ask the question more precisely.
Okay.
Right? When should you be a Baloo and when should you be a Bagheera?
Hmm.
Right?
Hmm.
And this is a very well-known, well-studied problem called the explore-exploit conflict.
Okay.
Right? Baloo wants to explore, you know, wants to check out all the different restaurants in town. Bagheera wants to exploit. Bagheera has found one good restaurant and Bagheera just goes there every time because Bagheera wants to maximize enjoyment, right?
Right.
So, which one should you be?
That's a question. I would ideally, if I'm really, really hungry, go Bagheera and I'm like, I'm going to the restaurant, I'm eating and then I'll think of everything else. But if I have time, I'll go Baloo and, you know, explore restaurants and whatnot. Is there like a rule of thumb when I should do which one?
I mean, so you have hit upon the simplest rule of thumb,
okay,
which is that if you don't have enough time and you already know something, right, then you should exploit. Just go for it. You don't have time to explore, right?
Okay.
Whereas when you have lots of time, then first you do exploration, right? More broadly, the rule of thumb could be that in the initial part of any new domain or any new project or any new area of expertise, right, do exploration. And then later on, once you have a bunch of candidates and you have found a good one, then you do exploit, right? For example, if you ever been in a company innovation seminar thing, they will talk about, you know, first there is just brainstorming, exploration without judgment. And only then you start narrowing down on the ideas, right?
Okay.
But this is simplistic, right? Life is more complex than that.
Yeah.
More generally, you can say something like, if the cost of exploration is low, then you should explore.
Okay.
Whereas if a cost of making a mistake is high,
Then exploit,
you shouldn't be exploring, right?
Right.
So restaurants, it doesn't cost you much to go to a new restaurant if you go to new restaurants regularly.
Correct.
But if you are like my mom who goes to a restaurant once a year, then you probably want to exploit.
Look, new restaurants sometimes might not agree well with your system.
Exactly.
So that's a cost of exploration,
exactly,
as you said.
So the two points here is that depending on the cost, you explore or exploit. And the second is this is different for different people and your stage in life, right?
Right.
Say you're talking about a degree. If you pick the wrong degree, the cost is reasonably high. So you can't go around exploring a lot. But for example, liberal arts colleges in India have started giving you the choice where you can explore without it having a high cost. You first spend the first 1.5 year exploring before you decide which one branch to exploit, right?
Yeah, makes sense.
Another possibility to think about is that when uncertainty is high, you don't know which one is a good one to exploit.
Okay.
So you have to explore, right? Because even if you think this is good today, right? I mean, you say that, well, you know, JavaScript programming is the future. But the world is changing so fast, especially with AI coming in, that the uncertainty might kill you. You might be stuck in the wrong exploit, right? So if uncertainty is high, you have to have explore going on at
constantly,
the same time, right?
Which is why you constantly keep saying that start exploring ChatGPT right now.
Yes, yes. And third thing is that if the rewards are highly uneven, right? As in something might give you such a tiny return and another might give you a huge return, then explore makes sense to have some chance of finding the high return thing.
Okay,
this is where we did an entire episode on how to think like a VC,
right,
where 10 different ideas, 9 of them fail and the 10th one gives you enough of a return that it makes up for all the other 9.
So, in a sense, VCs are actually exploring more than exploiting.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. Right. It's just that, you know, when out of their 10 companies, one really starts to take off, right? Then they might choose to exploit in the sense that they might invest in later stages of that company. Usually, VCs invest in early stage companies. That is explore. Right. Exploit is when you go for the IPO and things like that, right?
This entire discussion sort of tells me that there is a point where you switch from explore to exploit. Is that right?
No. So it can be more complex than that, but let me come to that, right? Okay. Before that, I've been talking in terms of cost, right? But the cost doesn't mean only cost in terms of money. It could be cost in terms of effort, or it could be cost in terms of time, right? So for example, if you've gone on a vacation, should you go to just like the 5 places that are world famous, or should you try out a whole bunch of back alleys and so on? Depends on whether it's a 5-day vacation or a 3-week vacation, or you're there for 6 months.
Right? And also depends on, like you said, the person himself, because there are people who might actually only explore the back alleys even though they have a 5-day vacation. Is that possible?
Possible, right? Okay. So, yeah. Their cost function is different. But also, one thing I do want to point out here, it's a bit of a distraction, is that we did an episode called Make 10-Year Plans, Don't Make 1-Year Plans, which means that if you make a 10-year plan, you have much more room to explore.
Correct.
So in general, I like saying that, but of course, you have to exploit, otherwise you will end up being poor and sad, right? So,
but in those 10-year plans, you essentially have accounted for the cost of time.
Yes, yes, absolutely. Now, coming back to your question about what is the right time to switch over, right? Turns out that this is a very well-studied problem in mathematics, okay? It's called the multi-armed bandit problem.
Multi-armed bandit?
Yes. If you have ever been to a casino, you would have seen a slot machine, right?
Yes.
You put money in, you pull the arm.
And the money goes away.
No. Well, you're supposed to win money, but largely those are terrible machines, okay? They return very little. So that is why it's called the one-armed bandit. It is just stealing your money.
Okay.
Now imagine that there are 10 different one-armed bandits standing in front of you. They are made by different companies.
Okay.
So one of them returns 95% of the money, one returns 87% of the money, one returns 99.8% of the money, and so on, right? So you want to maximize your returns.
You're still losing money, but whatever returns you're trying to maximize.
Yes. Yeah. Right. Oh, let us just assume that there is one that returns 110% and one that returns 150% also, just for the sake of maths, right?
Yeah.
So now you have these 10 machines in front of you, and you want to maximize your return. What do you do? Right?
You realize
that this is exactly the same problem we've been talking about.
Oh.
You have to first explore, and then when you find the best one, you have to exploit.
Correct.
Right? And how do you find the best one? To find the best one, you have to explore. But it's all probabilistic, so you still don't know when to stop exploring.
Yeah, because just one pull of the lever is not going to give me the reward.
So, people, as in mathematicians, have come up with a whole number of different algorithms to solve this, right? First one, simplest one, is called epsilon fixed, okay?
Okay.
Pick a number, epsilon, say 20%.
Okay.
And then you say that every time you have to choose one option, okay? With 80% probability, you will choose to exploit the best you have found so far.
Okay.
And with 20% probability, you will explore randomly.
Okay.
So that is, you have a fixed epsilon. Epsilon is the chance that you will explore. And throughout your life, you have a 20% chance of exploring. Anytime you have to make a choice, 20% chance that you will try something new, 80% chance you will go with the best you have.
Okay. But at the beginning of this thing, I don't have any clarity on which machine I'm supposed to exploit, right?
Yes, you're right. That is one of the weaknesses of this algorithm.
Okay.
Because in the beginning, you're exploring 100% of the time
because
there is nothing to exploit. And after a time, you build up what you are doing, right? A different algorithm is called epsilon decreasing. Okay, you start with 100% epsilon, which means you are always exploring. Then you decrease to 90%, then 80%, then 70% or so on. Or you have some other schedule. For example, there is this person, Henrik Karlsson on Twitter, whose epsilon decreasing strategy is that any new project, he breaks up into 30 months. First 10 months, he is in full explore mode.
Okay.
Next 10 months, he is 2/3 explore, 1/3 exploit. Next 10 months, he is 2/3 exploit and 1/3 explore and so on. Right?
That actually reminds me of another similar thing I heard recently by this guy called Noah Kagan. Now, Noah Kagan is basically the founder of a site called appsumo.com.
Yeah.
And he has come out with a book called Million Dollar Weekend.
Yeah.
In that he says, take 48 hours to develop an idea.
Yeah.
And in those 48 hours, if you can find three customers, then you focus on that idea. If you can't find three customers, you move on to the next idea.
Correct. Yeah.
So he's basically advising exploring 52 ideas in 52 weekends.
Correct.
And then exploiting whichever one of them actually hits.
Correct. So that is epsilon decreasing, right? Which is like you come up with a schedule saying that for this much period, I'm going to explore. After that, I'm going to exploit, right?
Right.
Going back to the first algorithm, fixed epsilon, that's called epsilon greedy, right? Do you know a great example of how it was used?
You said 20% epsilon, right?
Yes.
Oh, are you talking about Google and Orkut and all of those?
Correct. So Google, in the early days, used to give their employees the choice to spend 20% of their time working on any idea that the employee thought could be interesting to Google's business.
This was back when Google had the company motto, don't be evil.
Yeah.
That company motto doesn't exist anymore.
This was called the 20% time or the 20% rule.
Yeah.
And for example, Gmail has come out of one employee is 20% project, right?
Yeah. Orkut, so which used to be the social network before Facebook and was quite popular in Brazil and India, that also came out of the employee named Orkut's 20%.
So these are the two simplest algorithms. There are more complex algorithms that involve more calculations, but can give you even better results if you want to look up multi-armed bandit on Wikipedia, right?
I have a question.
Yeah.
All of this assumes that we are able to explore. What if there are restrictions on exploration? What if we can't explore freely?
Oh, that's a lovely question, right? And there is a very interesting problem.
This worries me, but
so,
go on.
It's called the arranged marriage problem.
This.
So keep in mind that this is mathematicians we are talking about, and they have restrictions on their imagination, okay? So imagine there is a sultan and he's going to get married and suitors from all over the world, politically important people, are bringing potential brides and the sultan talks to her and decides whether he wants to marry her or not. He has to say yes or no. Okay. Problem is that if he says no, he can't go back and say yes again to the same person. No is a no, right?
I believe this is a reality TV series called The Bachelor, but go
sure,
on.
Yeah. Now, here is the problem. Here is an explore-exploit conflict without the chance of exploration, right?
Right.
I mean, when you are talking to the first person, you don't know what the remaining 99 are going to be like.
Absolutely.
Right? So, do you say yes or no?
And
mathematicians have actually studied this and they have come up with a number
okay.
saying that if you know beforehand how many are the total number of brides, right? You just reject the first 37%.
Okay.
Okay. 37 comes from the fact that 37 is 100 upon E. E is Euler's constant, 2.717. Okay.
Okay.
But reject the first 37%. And then after that, say yes to the first one who is better than all the previous ones.
Naturally, of course. Naturally, because it's a natural law. Bad joke.
I mean, more generally, the point is that when you have, you can't go back and explore freely, right? Set aside roughly 37% of the time or the effort or whatever for exploration. And then after that, you switch to exploit.
Somebody right? should actually go back and, you know, do a study on the episodes and seasons of Bachelor and see if this 37% kind of holds and works or not. But then again, you had to take the example of marriage. And with marriage, matlab shaadi ka laddu, khao to pachtao, nahi khao to pachtao.
That is another lovely point you have brought up because...
Well, it meant as a joke.
No, so it is important. So the psychology of the explore-exploit conflict is this, that you can regret it either ways, right?
True.
Before you have taken the decision, you are stressed. Oh, how should I take a decision? Yeah. What if I make the wrong decision?
Yes.
How do I pick the perfect one? And so on, right? So you're fully stressed and you're unhappy, right? Afterwards, once you have taken the decision, whatever decision you have taken, you keep worrying, oh, should I have done that, right? If you have chosen to exploit one, you keep wondering, if I had explored, wasn't it better? Whereas if you have chosen to explore, you're like, oh God, look at those guys, they're doing so well, right? So, you're going to regret either way, right? So, probably the correct way is to pick a decent algorithm. Right? Yeah. Any one of the algorithms we talked about, either fixed 20% or a schedule of reducing this or 37% rule, pick one algorithm, stick to it, and then do not regret your decision. Tell yourself that I picked the correct process and I have right only to following the process. I do not have right to the results thereof. Karmanyavadhikaraste.
Mahapharishu kadachana.
Right.
Yeah, so whether you are a Baloo or a Bagheera, decide and live with it.
More precisely, first of all, be aware that there exist these two choices.
Okay.
Second is be aware that you don't have to be one or the other, right? There are these algorithms which let you choose dynamically.
Yeah.
And of course, that it's different for different areas of your life, right?
Right.
And finally, pick one strategy and don't sweat the results. Karmanyavadhikaraste, right?
That's an episode we did very early on in the series in this channel. And we'll put that up for you to check out. Do check it out and do let us know your honest thoughts like you've been letting us know on the comments. Thank you so much. But yeah, Baloo, Bagheera, choose, decide for whatever project you're doing and
go with the flow. This is Future IQ. I am Baloo, he is Bagheera. Or vice versa.
I am Baloo, he is Bagheera. Srikant, Naveen.